horses. Oh, my lads, you should have seen them running. Ask them why and they reply, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, walking down the valley road to see the burned in aces. You should have seen them running. Ask them why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, walking down the Marnie Road to see the burned in aces. Oh, my lads, you should have seen them running. Ask them why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, we're walking down the Marnie Road to see the burned in aces.
Plays it back to McAtee and chips it over to McGinlay. He's onside. John McGinlay put the ball in there. John McGinlay puts Bolton back on.
Stay there and playing with a style and aggression that says it won't be long before they put him to penalty. Stay there. John McGinlay, goal number one. Just as I say that, super John McGinlay after some good work by Scott Green.
A simple little 10-yard ball. Rollers off and over them. Absolutely right. There's a good ball. McGinlay! Bolton scored! John McGinlay! 35 minutes gone! All night you're jamming all your beer. And hanging out just like a street sign. McGinlay did that superbly. Sellers tries to feed him in through the middle. McGinley's got on. This time he can make it count. Superb striker play by John McGinlay.
The greatest. Does well, gets past his man. Gets the cross in.
Hello and welcome back to Wanderers Weekly. Thanks for tuning in, Wanderers fans. In part three in our up close and personal series, we're joined by Wanderers legend John McGinlay. Before we do bring John in, though, let's just leave you with this absolute beauty.
Greatest. Now McGinlay, this is what he likes to run at defenders. He's trying to chip. Oh, wonderful goal from John McGinlay. McGinlay makes his mark in the Premiership. To the elevated status. When he received the ball, there looked to be little danger, but that was improvisation, spotting the goalkeeper off his line, and a beautiful.
So on that note, let's bring John in, shall we? Hello, John. I hope you're keeping well back there, pal. Just how are things with you, mate?
Very good, thanks, Tom. Pleasure to be here, and thanks for inviting me on.
Yeah, many thanks for joining us here at Wanderers Weekly, pal. On a personal note, it's a massive privilege, obviously, growing up in the 90s, watching you play at Burnham Park. It's a huge privilege on a personal note. So just how were things with you? We know you've been covering Wanderers alongside Jack Dearden on BBC Radio Manchester. Just how enjoyable is that for you? Obviously, a true Wanderers great, coming back, covering the club that you love and reporting on Wanderers. It must take your mind back to where it all began, really.
Well, I think it's been a privilege, Tom, this season, if I'm honest with you. I've been very fortunate that I've been at the majority of games. So that's, you know, in this pandemic, I would say, then we've been lucky, you know, because I've been able to get and see games, more fortunate than other people. I wish we had supporters at some of the games we've had recently, because I think we would have taken the roof off, you know what I mean, with some of the performances and some of the noise that would have been in the stadiums. But no, it's been an absolute pleasure. You know, I think it was tough at the start of the season. We didn't go off to a great start, and it took us a long time to find our feet. You know, we had a good November, and then dipped again after that, really. And you know, we had sort of sporadic results, you know, that sort of kind of kept us going. But I really think that, you know, January was a big turning point, you know, with the quality that we brought into the squad in January. That seemed to turn the corner. You know, people got, you know, I think everybody got right behind the team as well at that point, you know, and the manager gave, obviously, the new players coming in, gave them an opportunity. They took it with both hands, and we haven't looked back since.
Yeah, I must say, I think it started with the 2-0 win over Salford City back on when it was on Sky. That was the, and Matt Gilkes coming in as well. Not just his influence on the pitch, but as you're at the games, you can hear him from where you are. You can hear him barking all his instructions to the players, and he's played a big part in this revival of form, do you reckon?
Well, I think it's easy to pick outfield players because obviously they're more involved, you know. And you know, we've got Ian Doyle scoring goals. We've got now a centre midfield of Kieran Lee and MJ, who's very experienced. And you look at Declan John at left back, he's brought in great qualities. Afellain, he's been a revelation since he's come in. And I think the partnership at the back of Santos and Baptiste has been absolutely out of this world. But I think the catalyst for it all has been Matt Gilkes. I really do. Because he brought a calmness to the back four. You know, since he's come in, his organisation, as you said, you can hear him. Where we're right up at the top, you know what I mean, in the stand. But we can hear him plain as day, giving out instructions, organising his defence and leading, you know, leading from the back as such. And he's made some really important saves in games. You know, so I think Matt Gilkes has made a fantastic difference for us. But I think everybody's raised their game. And it's been a total team effort. You know, it's been really good to watch. And the transformation from the start of the season where, to be honest with you, a lot of supporters had written the team off and possibly the manager as well, you know, but the manager has stuck by his guns, stuck by his beliefs, and slowly but surely the results started to turn, and now we're on a crest of a wave, you know, and we're the form team, not probably only in the league, in the country at the minute. We really are, and I think we're the team that nobody wants to play at this point of the season.
I think that Ian Everett does deserve a huge amount of credit because, like you say, when he joined from Barrow, everyone was thinking, is he really the man for the job? Not much experience in terms of managerial status, but with the way we started the season poorly, but the quality of players, like you spoke about, likes of MJ Williams and Lloyd Isgrove, obviously scoring now 2-2, but MJ Williams loves a tackle. The strength and depth of this, even the players that don't even feature, there's so much quality there. And that 14 game unbeaten, I know it came to an end at Newport, and that was our own doing, really, because we had loads of chances in the first half to kill that game off. So even when we do lose games, John, it's through our own doing. So we're creating those chances game in, game out.
Well, I think a big difference, Tom, when you look at it now, we've got such strength and depth. You know, I think at the start of the season, we could put out a decent 11 maybe onto the pitch. But any injuries, any loss of form, any changes at all seem to weaken the team. And you look at the team now, you know, the changes are made just to freshen things up, to finish the game strongly. And there's no drop-off in quality whatsoever. We've got pure depth on that bench and quality coming onto the pitch. And I'll be honest with you, the majority of the times changes have been made in games, they've all come on and made an impact. And it made a big impact on the game, either scoring a goal. You know, some of their performances have been just fantastic. They really have. And, you know, for me, Tom, I look at this team now, and it reminds me a lot of when I first came to the club. No, because a team that was built really from scratch, a team, the club had not a lot of money at that time. You know, and Bruce Drake obviously started to build things. I can see similar things in this team, you know, and it's, from my point of view, it's great because these guys are writing their own history. They're making their own history now, and it'll be remembered for a long, long time in what they're going to do this season.
It's quite remarkable when you look at it. 81 days ago, we were 17th in League Two, 4 points clear now with a fourth position with just 5 games to go. But taking 38 points from a possible 45, I mean, you've been in Championship winning Wanderers teams before. Where does this rank in terms of that, do you reckon?
Well, it ranks right up there because, I mean, there's no getting away from the fact that this is a really tough league. And the majority of, I mean, pretty much it's throughout the season, Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday. And I think the wise additions in January to really strengthen us. And now, like I said, we've got that strength and depth. That served us well over the period. And it's such a tough, demanding league because the games are frenetic. They're end-to-end. You know, we saw last night at Salford, you know, an end-to-end game where people, there was you know, no quarter given, no quarter asked. You know what I mean? There was tackles flying in. Typical local derby. But again, the pleasing thing from my point of view is I looked at our players last night, not only that started, but the players that came on, and they were bang up for it. They really were. And, you know, winning tackles, winning, getting blocks, important blocks in the box, you know, winning headers as they come into the box. People really, really wanted it last night. And you can see it. There's a goal at the end of the season, you know, and not only, yeah, it'd be great from after the start we've had to get automatic promotion, but we want to go and win it now. Make no mistake, we want to go and win it. And these players have got the taste of it and they want to go and win it. You can tell that from last night's performance.
I mean, you were there last night, John. We had to withstand a lot of pressure. Salford had large spells of possession, some great chances, and as we said off air before the show started, bodies on the line. It was an old-fashioned performance if you look at it, because you could say the modern game now, you don't see a lot of that. A lot of people fighting for the shirt and all out or nothing. And even when we scored the goal, the bench and the play and the people watching from the Wanderers bench, they were cheering every tackle, every shot. It was great to see that amount of passion shown from a Wanderers team.
Well, like last night, you know, I mean, Salford obviously is not a big stadium. There's six rows of seats, and then you're on the pitch. So you've got a depth of six seats. All the players that were there, the guys that were on the bench, the guys that had travelled and weren't named in the squad, to a man, every one of them were up cheering just about every tackle, every header won, you know, anything at all. And you can tell there's such a togetherness in the squad, in the dressing room. And that's winning us games on the pitch now. Tight games is making that difference.
Of course, John, you and your old pal Andy Walker celebrated your birthdays last week. So it's the best wishes from us to you both. I hope if Andy is watching this, hope you've had a good one, pal. Do you keep in regular contact with Andy?
We do. We swap texts and you know, obviously on birthdays and everything else. And Andy's got an open invitation from me. He knows if he's down this way, you know, because Andy obviously does the commentary on Sky these days. Yeah. He does a fantastic job on Sky. But if Andy's down this way and he has to travel down on a Friday, there's always a stop off here for a game of golf. So, you know, yeah, we keep in touch. And like I said, he's forced a great career in commentary.
We spoke about the good times this season, but after several years of trials and tribulations on and off the pitch, it's great to see the club now in a positive place, isn't it? Great ownership. What Sharon Britton has done is fantastic. A lot of trust in Ian Everton, and it's shown, really. But put those sad times behind us now, and it's been a great season so far.
Well, like you said, you know, we've been through some terrible times over the years, you know, and we all feel that we shouldn't be here. We all feel we shouldn't be in League Two, but we are. At this moment, we're a League Two club, and there's no getting away from that. But I think the owners have been brave. You know, I think they took over a club that was really struggling. And let's be honest, we went far off from going out of existence. So we thank them for saving the club and putting us back on an even keel. I think they showed great courage at the start of the season. It would have been easy maybe to make decisions because of the way the team was at that time. And they stuck by it, which now they're reaping the rewards. You know, I think nowadays, well, look at Salford on the third manager so far this season, because they can't seem to make up their mind what direction they want to go. So we've stuck at it and we're getting our rewards. And, you know, I think the one of the things, Tom, that sticks out for me is, you know, when I joined this football club back in 1992, it was a family club. You know, the players were really involved in the community, the club. You know, we knew pretty much the supporters' names. You know, you knew everybody. And that was it, because we were out in the community so much. We got to know everybody. And I think it's really important that the club does that, because, you know, when you're playing on a Saturday, there's a different responsibility on you, because you know people. You know you're going to meet people at the school gates on the Monday. You know when you're out shopping, when you're going to meet people, and the first thing they're going to say to you is, you were rubbish on Saturday, or you didn't perform, or what's happening with the team, or, do you know what I mean? So you think about that when you're playing, and I do think you put an extra 10, 15% into your game and try a little bit harder at times to win tackles, to win you, and that's it. And, you know, I think the more the club's gone, they made great strides in the last year or so in getting back to that. Obviously, COVID has played a part in maybe not getting out as much in the community, but that's nothing we can do. But the club is I know for a fact, reliant and they're really looking forward to get out in the community and playing a big, big part in the community again, like they used to do. And slowly but surely, we're getting back to that family club again.
Yeah, just speaking of that, it's great to see the return of the Junior Whites. Obviously, something that I was involved in when I was a young lad. So it's great to see that returning.
That's our future. That's our support. You know, that's our... And, you know, John, you look at it, right? And I was lucky. When I played at this football club, we had successful times. And we came from nothing, but we had success. And it was fantastic. And just about every kid in Bolton had a Bolton shirt. But now, you know, if you went to PE lessons, went to everything else, the majority are Man United, Man City shirts, because that's the teams they see week in, week out on the TV. So that's the teams they should support in their eyes, because they're the ones they see. They're the big names. So the more we get out in the community, the more we spread the word and we start to be successful, i.e. and starting up the Junior Whites again, that brings these young supporters back into our football club. And it starts them off on the right foot, you know, because again, as a generation, as we go down the line, they're our future support. So for me, we should always have a Junior Whites. We should always have had a Junior Whites. And it's great to see it back up and running.
So a bit more on you, John, and where things all started for you, really, as a youngster, playing your trade up in Scotland, developing into a top-notch goal scorer, starting out at Fort William, spending 4 years there. After those 4 years, did you develop more and more confidence, obviously scoring goals for absolute fun? What was the sensation when you look at that? And is it about developing confidence through scoring goals when you're that young?
That's what I played the game for, Tom. You know, I played the game to score goals. And it's... That's all I wanted to do was score goals. You know, and I'll be honest with you, if I played in a team that won 4-0 and I hadn't scored, I was always disappointed. Great that we won the game, but always disappointed because I didn't score. Do you know what I mean? I had to score a goal, and that was me. I played like I had to score a goal. And again, it's one of them, you know. It's for me, that was a be-all and end-all in the game, scoring.
After brief spells with several other clubs after Fort William, you really found your feet at Yeovil, joining the club in 85, spending 3 great years there, scoring plenty of goals in a competitive environment. Just how did you find that? Obviously, coming out of Scotland for the first time and coming to England.
Well, for me, it was a big step up, really, because at that time, it was a Gola League, which is now the Conference. And it was a good standard. Obviously, one below league football. So, I mean, it is a good standard. I mean, it pretty much nowadays is the fifth division, if you look at it. You know, the majority of teams now are full-time. But even in them days, you know, Yeovil was a huge non-league club. I think our average of attendance were 2,500, 3,000, you know, for home games. So for me, it was a big step up and really enjoyed my time there. Great people, made a lot of friends, still keep in touch with a lot of people down that way. Two of my boys were born down in Yeovil, actually. So, I mean, that was, you know, that was a good start as well. So, no, I enjoyed my time there. It really was. It was good.
After 3 years, you moved back up to Scotland as you joined Elgin City. Just how did that come about, and just how would you assess your time at Elgin?
Loved Elgin. Loved everything about Elgin. Elgin were probably the biggest club in the Highland League at that time. Good support, good ground, good town. And briefly, if I cut a long story short, when I was at Nairn County before that, my strike partner there was a guy called Steve Patterson. And Steve, further down the line, ended up player manager at Elgin City. Yeovil Town, my contract had come to the end of Yeovil. Well, I'd been coming. There was an option on my contract. The manager said if I went back to Scotland, he would let me go on a free. If I stayed in England, he wanted a fee for me. Steve had been in touch with me and wanted me to go back up the road to give a go at it. So I did. And that was it.
So after brief spells at Shrewsbury and Millwall, you came to Burnden Park in 92, playing under the guidance of Bruce Rioch. Just how did the move to Bolton Wanderers materialise, John? Just how did that start?
Well, Bruce was my manager at Millwall. So obviously I'd gone in there, and it was a bit of a shock to my system, if I'm totally honest with you. I went into Millwall, and I would say I probably wasn't the best professional in the world at that time. you know, I was probably late. I was sloppy. You know what I mean? I took it as I found it, basically. And I think Bruce instilled a lot of discipline in me. I was probably scared of him, if I'm honest with you. Do you know what I mean? Great manager. And I'll be honest with you, I owe him really for turning me around, if that makes sense. Because I think from that point on, I took my football serious. And that's down to him. And a good time at Millwall. Bruce had left, got the job at Bolton. Had been in touch with me to say that they wanted to sign me. And I said, well, look, I'm waiting on the phone call. Just tell me when. And that was during the summer. But it took them until the end of September to gather the money together to be able to come back and buy me from Millwall. So, and that happened. And I'll be honest with you, before the phone was put down, I was in the car and gone. You know, when I finally got that phone call to say, right, we've got the money together, we've agreed terms, I was on the road, I was on the way up to Bolton.
Yeah, in terms of your first season at the club and that 92-93 campaign, it was a fantastic start for you on a personal note, combining really well with Andy Walker that first season. I think Andy scored 33 goals in that first campaign.
Andy was on fire. Andy was, what a finisher, what a goal scorer. I mean, Andy... I think we were lucky. You know, nothing was planned. Nothing was really worked on. I think we just seemed to hit it off together straight away in training. Our movement complemented each other, our work rate. And the good thing about it was that if I didn't score, Andy scored. If Andy didn't score, I scored. If not, we both scored. You know, I mean, it was good, really good. And the partnership was fantastic. There's no doubt about that. And as I said, Andy, you could rely on Andy to score every time he played, just about. So, you know, the unfortunate thing was we went on a fantastic run. And again, similar to a little bit similar to this season, because when I joined the club, I always remember we were 18th in the league. And at the end of September, so the beginning of October, we were 18th in the league. And then we went on a fantastic run. And pretty much coming to the end of the season, we know we couldn't afford to get beat. And Andy picked up a serious knee injury on Easter Monday, home to Swansea. And Andy, that was Andy done for the season. And everybody then thought, well, that's our hopes gone. That's us finished. But we were lucky. Julian Darby played up front with me then. And Julian scored a couple of really important goals. I think he scored one against a home to Stoke, who won the league that year. We finished second. And Julian scored the goal. We beat them 1-0 at home. And we kept the run going. And on the final day, we got promotion home to Preston. So similar to this year's team in the way that, you know, we went on a fantastic run. And Andy, you know, obviously missing out at the end because of injury. And thankfully, Andy came back the following season. So everything worked out in the end for us.
So after that first season, I know you said there you scored 22 goals.
Yeah.
Are you the type of player that sets yourself individual targets for season on season? And were you happy with that contribution? And that's obviously seeing the promotion, your first season at the club and scoring that many goals, you must be really pleased with how you started things.
Absolutely. I mean, I was chuffed would be an understatement. I was delighted. I think every striker at the start of the season, although they won't publicly say it or put it out there. But I think everybody says 20 goals. You know, I think everybody sets their target at 20 and then you take it from there, don't you? Once you've hit 20, you know you've been going well anyway, so you should score more than that. And I think that was always the case with me. I always kind of set myself a target of 20 at the start of the season and see where it takes you.
So the following season, you enjoyed a staggeringly impressive campaign, scoring a hatful of goals, finishing the season as top goal scorer, a great run to the quarterfinals of the FA Cup in those memorable wins over Everton and then Arsenal. In terms of progression from the previous campaign, you must have been really pleased with that season.
Again, hugely, I think it was a big step up to the Championship. I think from the club point of view, it was a bit of a consolidation season. You know, it was like a mid-table, just above mid-table season, but a comfortable season. And as you said, another fantastic cup runs and big cup games. well, giant killing games. Again, the White Hot Knights were fantastic. And on a personal note, yeah, I got 33 that season, which equaled Andy's 33 the season before. And I think it was only Sir Nat that had a 33 as well. I think the three of us, since Sir Nat's times, that was the case. So that was an honour in itself.
So after another successful campaign, you enjoyed another astonishing season with the club, reaching the Coca-Cola Cup final in 95, just losing out to Liverpool, finishing the season in third, winning promotion to the Premier League for the first time in the club's history via the playoffs, finishing the season as top scorer again. In terms of most memorable seasons in the 90s, that was really up there for me. And the Coca-Cola Cup final was right in it. That playoff final win, just how would you summarise that season?
Well, I think, I mean, again, what an honour to go and play in a major cup final at Wembley, number one, you know. I mean, to go there, Liverpool, huge game. I mean, I thought we performed great on the day. I think the difference between two teams was Steve McManaman, who had an absolute worldie of a day. But I'll tell you what, Alan Thompson had a worldie of a day as well that day. And there wasn't much between him and Steve McManaman. Tomo himself scored an unbelievable goal, left foot strike, top corner on the swivel, put it away. And he also pulled off a save. The goalkeeper's fingertip went over the bar. It was going in the top corner from Tomo as well. So, on a different day, two bits of magic from Steve McManaman, a couple of bits of magic from Tomo, one that really counted at the back of the net. Close game, but no shame probably in getting beat 2-1 by Liverpool. But I think that experience of that day at Wembley in the major cup final, sellout crowd, set us up and stood us in good stead for the playoff final. You know, coming, what, 6-8 weeks later? And obviously going down there, we'd experienced it before, so it wasn't a shock to us. The big shock to us was the way we started against Reading, because we couldn't get near them. And before we could blink, really, we were 2 goals down. We were 2-0 down in the game. And again, it was one of them games where it wasn't expected. They were like Brazil on the day. And it came to the stage in the game where we give away a penalty to make it 3-0. But Keith Brannigan steps up and makes an unbelievable save. And from that point onwards, it was all us. You know, Keith Brannigan deserves every credit in the world for what he did. In fact, you know, it changed the history of the football club, that save. And when you look at it, and I still think to this day, I don't think he's had the credit he deserves for that save. I really don't. And probably because the fact is he's a quiet, shy guy that just got on with his job. But what a save. I mean, absolutely. I mean, at 3-0, we may as well go home. At 2-0, we've still got a great, great chance. And you know, we've got in at half-time, 2-0 down. The boss has made some changes, changed the formation a little bit. And we've gone out that second half and played some unbelievable football. The team, fantastic. Got ourselves back in, equalised with 5 minutes to go. And then the fitness proved the issue in overtime. And we ran all over Reading in extra time and got the goals we deserved, and that was it.
I was going to say, did that late Fabian De Freitas goal, did that give the lads that lift heading into extra time, do you reckon?
Oh, without doubt. I mean, it was only a matter of time. I mean, it had been coming the whole second half. We had been bombarding them. Fabian, excellent. Just to pop up with 2 goals, absolutely brilliant for him. I mean, he'll be remembered forever for them 2 goals. Big Mixo as well, getting on the score sheet and on coil, you know, with a header at the back post. So 4 good goals, well-worked goals, and thoroughly deserved the result in the end.
Yeah, I can imagine the dressing room was absolutely bouncing after the game, John. Into the Premier League for the first time in the club's history. I imagine it was quite a party for you all that night.
It was unbelievable. It went on for a few days. It wasn't just a night. It went on for a while, if I'm honest with you. But no, it was great. It was, you know, it's memories like that, you know, sitting. We were staying at a hotel called Burnham Beaches, which the England team used to use before home internationals and everything else. And we were staying there. And I remember just sitting there, sitting around on the sofa, trophy on the table, Sir Nat sitting next to me with a glass of champagne, tear in his eye. Do you know what I mean? Just, I always think back, you know, the big games, because they're the games that really made Nat happy. You know what I mean? And for me, the happiness I got was seeing him smiling with a tear running down his face, because I've never seen a man so happy when his football club did well. You know, the man lived and breathed Bolton Wanderers Football Club. He dedicated his life to Bolton Wanderers. And not just that, such a gentleman, such a humble, humble guy, and just a great presence. You knew you were in the presence of greatness when you were sitting with Sir Nat and having a chat about football. It was an honour.
Yeah, so you spoke about Keith Brannigan. What a guy he was. Obviously, after the Coca-Cola Cup final, I was in assembly. I think I was only 8 years old. I was in assembly in primary school, and all of a sudden they announced that Keith Brannigan's there. It's like a lucky winner has won a competition to sort of spend the day with him. And I was a lucky lad. I sort of spent the day with Keith, had pictures took with the Bolton News, all that sort of stuff, and actually got invited to be a ball boy as well at Burnden, sort of behind the goal with him. And I got to know him really well for about 18 months or so. But he was such a hero, and what he's done for the club, like you say, he's really stood the club in good stead for those years in the 90s.
Again, such a humble guy, you know, and an unassuming guy, you know what I mean? And great goal. I mean, best goalkeeper I played with, without doubt. And, you know, he was just a good guy. You always felt assured with him. You know, just a good starting block for the team, really. You know what I mean? He made his big saves when they were needed. He was a calming influence at the back. And a good guy. He was a funny guy as well. You know, he had a dry sense of humour, funny, and great part of the dressing room.
So playing in the Premier League, John, it must have been a great feeling, obviously. And despite being relegated, just how would you assess the feeling of coming up against the world's best in that season? I imagine you had up and down emotions in that season.
Yeah, it was a tough. It was really tough, and I think, you know, you look back on it now, you know, if you were honest and truthful about it, it probably came too early for us. I think the success we had in a short space of time kind of culminated in the fact that we ended up in the Premier League, but we were by far ready for it. We weren't anywhere near ready for it. And, you know, I think I started that season. By that time, obviously, the boss had gone to Arsenal. So that was a big blow to start with. Colin Todd and Roy McFarland had taken over as joint managers, which, you know, looking back now, probably wasn't the right decision. And, you know, Roy McFarland, what a guy. A fantastic man, great man, a gentleman. But I think you need one boss, one manager, one boss, somebody you go to. I think at that time, the players were in a bit of confusion. Who do they go and speak to if they've got a problem? Who do they approach? And if you approach one, does the other one think you're undermining them? It causes all sorts of problems. And I was club captain. So the players were coming to me and saying, well, who do I go to? What do I do? And I couldn't give them an answer because I didn't know myself. You know, so a difficult, difficult season. The change was made in, I think it was January, the change was made where Colin took over as number one. Roy left the football club. But I think that season we gave, although we weren't ready for it, we gave too much respect to other teams. No, we played a 4-5-1 system. I played wide right of midfield for the whole of the season. Nathan Blake played up front on his own. I played as a wide right winger, let's say, and a wide right midfield player. So I felt we didn't give it a go as we probably should have. I think we tried to contain teams and try, you know, to maybe sneak a win rather than go out and play as we did in cup games the previous couple of years and where we got our success. You know, I would question the fact whether we could do it on a consistent basis, but you just came away from that season feeling that you didn't give it a proper go.
So back into the first division during the following season, John, you really found your feet again from a goal-scoring perspective. Scoring a hatful of goals again, another sensational campaign, winning the league outright. After a disappointing campaign in the top flight, it must have felt so good to win the league and sort of send out a real statement after that disappointing season.
Well, I think the when you look back, I mean, don't get me wrong, fantastic season. I think it was probably one of the best seasons in the football club's history. But you look back, and I think you saw the partnership myself and Nathan had had. I hit 30 goals that season. Nathan hit 24. So there's 54 goals between the two of us. And then you start thinking, well, I wonder what we could have done if we had done that in the Premier League. You know, rather than play the way, set up the way we did, you know, if we had that opportunity to play together in the Premier League, things might have been a little bit different. And that was a disappointment. But I think that season, 96-97, it'll live with me forever. I mean, and it'll live with a lot of people forever because, you know, I think the culmination was the last game at Bundon Park. We gave the stadium the proper send-off that it deserved. I mean, you know, all the ex-players there from down the generations were there. Again, Sir Nat's walking around the pitch before the game with tears in his eyes, as many of the ex-players had tears in their eyes because it was such an emotional night. You know, it was Sky cameras were there. It was a full house. I mean, and we went in the half-time 1-0 down. You know, the occasion, I think, maybe got to us a little bit in the first half. We didn't really get out of second gear, really, in the first half, but we made amends in the second half and blew Charlton away, really, in the second half, scoring four goals. So we gave it the fitting result that the stadium and the history deserved. But it was a sad night. As much as it was a joyous night, we got the trophy that night for the championship, it was a sad night as well because we knew we were leaving a special place.
So after winning that first division title, scoring a load of goals, you decided to make the move away from Burnham Park. I can't imagine that was an easy decision to make after some great years at the club, scoring over 100 goals, leaving for Bradford City in the end. Just talk us through that, and I imagine it wasn't an easy decision to make, John.
Well, no. We moved up to the Reebok initially, and I was still involved in the first few games at the Reebok. But I'd been struggling, Tom. If I'm honest with you, I'd been struggling for about towards the end of the season, the 96-97 season. I'd been struggling for the last couple of months there with injury. And my Achilles had started to really play up. I'd been getting cortisone injections into my Achilles. I also had a thigh problem as well that had been giving me a bit of jip as well. But the Achilles was the main thing. And I found at the start of the next season, I was having to go in about an hour before we started training, and I was out on the training field trying to loosen off before we start, just to be able to train. And it was getting worse and worse, and consequently I was going back to see a doctor, and I was getting more cortisone put in it, which wasn't great. And that ended up... The problem with me, with Tom, is I'll be totally honest with you, I just wanted to play football. And it was my life, the be-all and end-all. I wanted to play football and score goals. The following summer was the 98 World Cup as well. And I wanted to be involved in that. I knew at my age it was the last chance I've got of playing in a major tournament with Scotland. And I found that hard to take because that was like before I even had an opportunity. And with the injury, with what Colin had said, in my head was, I've got to play. I've just got to be playing. I can't accept the fact that I'm not going to play. I've got to be playing. And Bradford had come in for me. Sunderland had made an inquiry. Manchester City had made a slight inquiry. There was a few other teams that had made inquiries about me. But Bradford had come in, spoke to the football club, who had asked for a certain fee, and they had agreed it. And then they got permission to speak to me. And I was a little bit disappointed that the club had made it that easy, really, for it to happen, if that makes sense. But it kind of told me that maybe the end is there, if that makes sense. You know what I mean? So anyway, it came about, wanted to play, wanted to try and play, didn't want to leave, just wanted to play. But with being told that you're probably going to be a squad player, I found it hard to accept. So I made the move. And I'll be honest with you, I regretted it as soon as I did it. I found it very hard. I mean, when you leave a football club that you love and you go to somewhere brand new, especially at my stage of my career, I was towards the end of the career anyway, and you know, I thought I was going to be here forever at Bolton, and to leave, it just didn't feel right, it didn't look right. And I think the day I left, I think my passion, my heart, everything stayed here, and I went to play football elsewhere without that, and that was a big part of my game, and I think that's why, you know, that was the end.
Yeah, after spells with Bradford and Oldham, you made the move to America. What was the reasoning behind that, and just how did you find the whole experience in the USA?
Well, I got an opportunity initially to go out as a player coach out to Cincinnati in America. So I went out initially, signed a 3-year contract, and I loved it. I loved the place. I loved the people. I thought it was fantastic. The problem was the football club that I had joined and the contract that I'd signed, nothing ever materialised, if I'm honest. My wages weren't paid. I got paid nothing. I'd signed a 3-year contract and basically it wasn't worth the paper it was written on. The contract was reneged on. I walked out after, I think, 3 months because of that. We stayed there. Myself and my family stayed there. And in fact, we went for a little tour. We went for a bit of a tour around America and had a good time for 6 months or so, finally coming back in November that year. And the reason we came back is I found my mother was ill and we made the decision to come back. So we moved back, basically after 10 months, we moved back.
So, John, you played with some fantastic names at Burnham Park, the likes of Andy Walker, Mixi Patalainen and Fabian De Freitas, etc. You must look back on those times with great fondness, especially those promotion parties. I bet you all had some fun as well as taking it seriously on the pitch.
No, listen, we did. And we were a squad that played hard, trained hard, and we also enjoyed ourselves as well together. And again, it's that togetherness. When we did something, we all did it. We played golf, we went to the horse race, and we went out, had a drink. Whatever we did, the majority of the squad did it. You know, if they could make it, they'd be there. And that was it. It was an unwritten rule, really. Everybody does it together. And when you're doing that, you're forging the relationships off the pitch as well as on the pitch. And I think that shows, you know, when one player gets kicked, we all get kicked. And you see the reaction. When you look back these days, you know, the Wolves games, etc., you see the reaction where the whole team's there. There's not one person missing. Everybody's there. Everybody's involved. And that's a team spirit. That's a dressing room. That's a dressing room that won't be beat. And I was fortunate. I played in teams like that. And as you said, some of the players you've mentioned, you know, and, you know, Nathan Blake, Owen Coyle, Andy Walker, Mixu, Fabian. I was blessed to be able to play with these guys. Really was. And yeah, goal scorers got a lot of credit. But look at the players around us. Look at the players that created the chances. You know, they're the real guys. And, you know, what a team. What a fantastic team and great guys.
You know, a player I want to mention really is David Lee. Obviously, a fantastic player in his heyday. He was manager of the under-23s until about 18 months ago. So he lives and breathes Bolton Wanderers as well. And it's great to see him in a role at Bolton previously, obviously after he retired from the game.
David did a great job with the 23s. He really did, Tom. What a role model. You know, and as a player, he was always our outlet. We knew we could put the ball in behind the fullback. 9 times out of 10, David gets on the end of it, gets his cross in, somebody's on the end of it, predominantly a goal. You know, and again, Tony Kelly, the same. Yeah. You know, pass master. You know, he calls himself the Prince, by the way, but he made that name up. The Prince of Passing, that's what he calls himself. or Zico Kelly. But no, great. You look back, characters. You know, Tony still lives in the town, does a lot in the community, does a lot out there, the charities, everything else. Ambassador at the football club. You know, and there's a lot of, these are two guys, there's a lot more as well that stayed local, you know, older guys and everything else. And they came, played for the football club, were made such a part of the town and the club, they ended up staying here. And that says a lot about the town. This is a fantastic town, fantastic people, heart of gold. They'd give you anything. People in Bolton would help you in any way they can. They'd give you your last pound to help you. You know, they're that type of people, salt of the earth. And yes, they demand. Of course they do. They demand the football team does well. They want to see them working hard on the pitch and getting results, because this is a working man's town. You know, people work hard for the money in this town. It's hard to come by. And when they pay their money to come in and watch us on a Saturday, they want to see a performance. And that's not too much to ask for.
I know we've not mentioned it yet, John, but I must mention your rivalry with Wolves, if you will. Some great memories against Wolves. Let's just talk about that. That playoff semi-final at Burnham Park, though, what a night that was.
That, I mean, there's lots, I suppose, but that's one of the ones that really stick out, because, you know, when you look at it, we went down to Molyneux in the first leg and they battered us. They really did. They battered us. We had Peter Shilton in goals that day, you know, through injuries. You know, Peter was in goals, made some great saves. Wolves have ended up winning the game 2-1. Jason McAteer scored a great goal, 25, 30 yards out, put it over the goalkeeper. It was a great goal. I still think it came off his shin that day, but he's adamant he meant to do it in the top corner. But we got away with that one. We really did, because it could have been 4 or 5-1 that day. They had us penned in. There was lots of, again, players putting their bodies on the line, getting blocks. Peter doing well at the back, marshalling his defence, heroics at the back from the defenders. And we got away with a 2-1. We get back to Burnham Park, and the place, the atmosphere that night was absolutely electric. I mean, you couldn't fit a sheet of paper in that ground that night. You know, it was that packed out. And the noise, when we walked up that tunnel before the start of the game, the noise hit you, nearly knocked you back down the tunnel. You know, the roar, it was fantastic. And big rivals, you know, in them days with Wolves as well. You know, obviously, Wolverhampton Wanderers, Bolton Wanderers, we're the one and only Wanderers. And the rivalry goes back to Sir Nat and Billy Wright's days. And we sort of rekindled that, you know, that rivalry. And it was the first games we looked for, you know, at the start of the season and looked forward to. And you look at it that night, I think I scored a goal. Jason McAteer clipped a great pass into me. And I got through and managed to finish it for the first goal just before half time. That settled us down. And then we went to the second half, and obviously you're going to mention the handbags and the little skirmish and all that we had moment in the corner. And I should have got a red card, there's no doubt about that. And David Kelly probably should have got a red card as well. But the referee, where it happened, he was right in front of the Wolves fans. The Burnham Terrace, the corner there where the supporters met kind of each other there. Mm. I think if he had shown us a red card, there would have been riots. People would have been over the fences. There would have been riots. There would have been carnage. And I think the referee kind of bottled it in the end, showed us both a yellow card, but it should have been reds. And probably to compound that, I've gone pretty much up the park and scored the second goal, make it 2-0. And really, ever since that day, I've just been abused, let's say, by the Wolves fans. Even to this day, you honestly, I get it all the time. When we got relegated last year, I blocked 400 Wolves fans over a Saturday. I was just getting abused. I just kept blocking on my Twitter thing. And people that weren't even born are giving me abuse, you know what I mean? And like, who weren't even, nothing to do with it. So I think it's they remember me to this day. And I don't think they'll forget it.
So just what was it against Wolves that gave you that extra confidence to do well against them? Was it a case of, yeah, I've played well against them before, I've scored goals against them? Did that just give you confidence every time you played them? Or was it just we just associate Wolves with John McGinlay, don't we? That's just...
I think it was just one of them teams where I scored goals against them, simple as that. You know, and I think I look at it, you know, obviously I was the one scoring the goals for us, and Steve Bull was probably their guy scoring the goals. And I hardly remember Steve scoring against us. I think he did. He scored in that first leg at Molyneux in that game. But other than that, I can't really remember him scoring against us. So the big games, instead of them shouting at me, maybe I shouted at him a bit more. Do you know what I mean? But I think they were treated, the games were treated more like a local derby. You know what I mean? That was the feel in the Wolves games. It was a local derby, and we wanted to come out on top. And I think it got to the stage where, as the message there was, listen, if you want to come and fight us, come and fight us, because we'll batter you. If you want to play football against us, we'll out football you, no problem. So you take the pick. And they tried different ways. They tried to come and fight us, and we battered them. They tried to play football, we battered them. And that was it. And I think we just had that, I think we just had that sign over them, really, whereas we had our way with them.
So you've had so many highlights at the club. Let me cast your mind back to when you went in goal after Paul Keeve was sent off. Just talk us through that experience.
I think people were worried because it was like, obviously, Keith's come flying out of his box. It was against Reading. He's taken the player down, referee straight out, red card. And no hesitation, simply up, right, gives a shirt, gives the gloves. And Branny's dressing me, he's putting the gloves and that on for me, you know, and I put his shirt on and shirt's down past my knees and it kind of drowned me. And I think people probably looked at me and thinking, why is he going in goals for? But if truth be known, after, not every day, but after training, quite often after training, myself or Scott Green would go in goals. And you normally find the goalies wanted to take a few shots. You know what I mean? So I'd be flying about in the mud and everything, making saves and everything else. And it was just a natural reaction when he got sent off. We didn't have a sub goalkeeper. So it was a case of, yeah, get the gloves and give it a go. And another great night. I mean, it was, when you think back now, I think at that time it was just a natural thing to do. But now when you look back, it's actually quite funny. And it's a nice memory now when you look at it.
Speaking of goalkeepers, what did you make of the current situation with more times than not, Ian Everett doesn't really name a substitute goalkeeper. There's been a handful of times where he has, but what do you make of that?
Well, again, it's one of them where, you know, I think nowadays seven subs, you look at it, do we need seven outfield players on the bench, or could you squeeze a goalkeeper in? And Ian's made that decision where I think we've had two times in recent memory, I think we've had a goalkeeper on the bench, the young lad in from Jensen in from Burnley, been on the bench a couple of times. Other than that, we've got away with it. You know, I think, you know, to go through to the end of the season now and hopefully nothing happens and we're unscathed and untouched, Matty Jilks gets us through to the end of the season, that's fine. And, you know, if that's the manager's way, that's the manager's way. I think we've become sort of accustomed to it now, haven't we? I looked at it the first few games when it happened, and I thought, God, I hope something doesn't happen. But now you tend to just forget about it. It's become the norm. You know what I mean? You just look at it now and think that's the way it is.
Yeah, there was a game, I think it was Port Vale away, where Matt Jilks went down, and there was a big angst mm-hmm. of it amongst the Wanderers fans and stuff. And I think Ian Everett said after the game that the bench was quite worried at that point.
Yeah, I think it was Port Vale away, wasn't it, where he took a knock on his foot or his ankle in, I think it was the first half. It was early in the game, actually. Mm. And you think, oh, no, here we go. But, you know, he recovered okay and he didn't seem to have any problems after that. But it did. I think it probably made the manager think twice, maybe just to, you know. I think now, especially, because you're becoming so close to maybe getting to where you want, you would hate to maybe trip up because you haven't had a goalkeeper on the bench. Just God forbid anything happened and you didn't have, and that cost you. I think you'd be mindful of that a little bit.
So, John, before we do call it a day, pal, have you got a message for the Wanderers fans watching this?
Yes, I think finally we're on the right path. You know, as a football club, We're certainly on the way back. There's no doubt about that. It's been a shame, especially this since the new year. It's been a shame that nobody's been able to be in the ground and witness some of the performances, because some of them have been fantastic. Some of the football we've played has been outstanding at times. It really has. And it's a tough league to play football. And again, the manager's had to stick by his beliefs. He's been adamant since he's come in the door that he wanted to play football. You know, and a lot of people kind of questioned that at the start through the results. But now we're bearing the fruit of sticking by. I think everybody's excited to get back involved again. You know, to get promotion this season from where we've come from, it's absolutely, the turnaround's been phenomenal. And I think everybody can look forward to next season and to come in and seeing this team perform. And, you know, you think about it, they've performed well in an empty stadium. How do you think they're going to perform when they've got 15,000 Bolton fans cheering them on and really getting behind them? This team could go on and do some really good things. And we can all look forward to next season in League, hopefully in League One. And I just think, honestly, I'm proud to see the way our football club's going now. I really am. And I'm happy knowing that we've got owners who aren't into fleece the club, who aren't into basically finish the club. They want to grow it. They want to do it the right way. They're not throwing silly money at it to do it. They're trying to build it in a sustainable fashion that's going to serve us for a long time to come. And again, getting back to being that family club, that club that's out in the community helping the town and giving something back. Because I think for too long, this football club it's been one way where we've taken a lot and not given a lot back. And it's now we are giving a lot back in the community and being part of the town again. And together, the town, the football club, all us as supporters, will get back to where we want to be.
I don't want this to be taken out of context, but Ian Everett actually a few weeks ago actually said that having no fans in the ground has actually been the reason why they've been doing so well, because at the start when they were struggling, there were no fans to boo them or get on the team's back, and that sort of really helped the team go on that 14 game unbeaten run. It's a strange one because it's never happened before. So
no, I think you're right, Tom. I think. And I think, as supporters, sometimes we're not as patient as we should be. And I think that's due to the fact that the way the football club has gone over the recent history. Mm. We've had some tough times. We nearly lost our football club. And I think when people see the team maybe not performing as they think they should be, there's a reaction. And it's frustration. That's all it is. It's frustration because they don't want to see us going out of business. They don't want to see us sitting at the bottom of League Two. And we had a poor start. And there's a lot of reasons we had a poor start. You know, and I think that it's no surprise it's in public knowledge that I think the recruitment had a lot to be desired, at the start of the season. I don't think they were, well, I know, the majority of them weren't Ian Everett's players. So when you go into a football club and it's new to you and you're handed players, and I think handed players that don't enhance the way you want to play, and yet you've got to try and make the best you can of these players in your beliefs to play the way you want to play, it's square pegs and round holes. And that's what we've gone through. And the club, obviously, I think had made a couple of mistakes in their backroom staff at the start of the season, which was rectified. And I think then you saw the difference. And when you look at it, again, it's remarkable to be able to come back from that to where we are now. It's kind of, do you know what? People don't even talk about the start of the season now and don't even mention it because of where we are. And I do agree with Ian that it would have been rough in the ground going through the games and going through the results and everything else. Yeah, it would have been tough. And it's probably did these players a favour that they've come in now, been able to find their feet, find that winning formula, and now the supporters are scratching at the gates to try and get in, wanting to come and see the team because we're going well. And it's afforded them the opportunity, isn't it, to find their feet at the football club. And now the players are excited, wanting the fans back in now. The fans are clamouring and wanting to get in to see games. And it's going to be fantastic. It really is. I mean, that I can't wait for the first game that we get fans back in the door and we get that roar and we get the togetherness and we start to forge and build that relationship between the fans and the team.
So, John, it's been a real honour speaking to you today, pal. A real hero of mine growing up, so thanks for that, pal.
Listen, I thoroughly enjoyed it, Tom, and thank you very much indeed. And again, everybody out there, back the channel, get in touch, and, you know, great. This club's going back to where it should be.
So massive thanks there to John McGinlay for joining us tonight. That was a lot of fun, John. Many thanks again for tuning in, Wanderers fans, and we'll see you all next time. Please don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel. Once again, John McGinlay, thank you very much, pal. That was very enjoyable.
Thanks, Tom.
Oh, my lads, you should have seen them running. Ask them why, and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, walking down the Manny Road to see the burned in aces. Oh, my lads, you should have seen them running. Asked them why, and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, walking down the Manny Road to see the burned in aces. Oh, my lads, you should have seen them running. Asked them why, and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, we're walking down the Manny Road to see the burned in aces.